It is a big idea, a new world order.
Your world is not what it seems. Alex Ansary, Outside the Box.
Reporting live, July 10th, 2008. I'm Alex Ansary, and you're watching Outside the Box, again live from Portland, Oregon, Stumptown. We're going to be here live over the course of the next hour, taking a few of your phone calls at 503-288-4442. Our surprise guest is not with us this evening. He's MIA. We will reschedule with him in several weeks' time, but he's a guest that we definitely want to get back on the show in the future. We have a lot of news we're going to cover this evening. We'll talk about the Middle East. We'll talk about Iran. We'll talk about the economy and take your phone calls on that particular issue, how you're dealing with the crisis, how you're struggling, and how you are looking at what your needs are going to be in the near future, the next year, 2 years, as we get ready to face this meltdown, which will be global. How are you prepared to take care of yourself and your loved ones? A lot of earth changes, a lot of other things taking place. British UFO sightings reach bizarre levels. Here's another report. U.S. finds that it's getting crowded in space. So I want to begin, though, with what I think is one of the biggest reports of the entire week, a new scientific discovery. And this changes things in a lot of different ways. Now, this comes to us from National Geographic, and it's a big one. Earth's core and magnetic field is now changing fast, according to a new study, which says that rapid sudden changes in the churning movement of Earth's liquid outer core is weakening the magnetic field in some regions of the planet's surface. Now, the findings suggest that quick changes are simultaneously occurring in the liquid metal 1,900 miles below the surface of our planet. One scientist involved in the study says the changes may suggest the possibility of an upcoming reversal of the geomagnetic field. So what does this mean for us? Well, I can actually talk about this for a full hour. Some people more eloquently about this topic than I can. There's a lot of interest in the magnetic field and theories about it shifting, even pole shifts. But in short, the decline in the magnetic field overall is opening the Earth's upper atmosphere to intensely charged particle radiation. We're a little bit more susceptible to all the stuff that's out there. And that includes asteroids, by the way. The particles can affect technical and radio equipment and can damage electronic equipment on satellites and airplanes. It also affects human and animal behavior as well, and the weather. Oddly enough, we are on the cusp of entering sunspot cycle 24, which is something that's been making the headlines recently over the course of the last year. But there are also reports coming out in the late 90s about how other planets in our solar system are heating up. Even some planets as far away as Pluto, they talked about Mars heating up. And so this also contradicts the official conspiracy theory as to what is causing global climate change. I also want to say that there is an Associated Press report out this week that talks about how CO2 contributes to the growth of plants. This is actually a scientific fact, and it's making headlines as well. But in addition to all those things taking place with the magnetic field and other things taking place in space, in terms of the planet, a couple more earthquakes have taken place since we spoke last. On the 4th of July, Russia saw a 7.7. Three aftershocks were also reported. A couple days later, on the 6th of July, a magnitude 6.2 earthquake hit southern Peru. On the 8th of July, we saw a Richter scale 6. Hit the Ryukyu Islands in Japan. There's also another earthquake in Tokyo recently. July 9th, rain brings flash flood warnings in South Wales in the UK. And now we have another report. Today, flash floods warning as heavy rain on way to Northern Ireland. Now, Evacuations continue in Chile after a volcano in Santiago spewed pyroclastic rock 1,300 feet into the night sky early this morning. And so they've just been having a lot of regular stuff, occurrences with that particular volcano, several volcanoes in Chile. In terms of Iran, a lot of other developments taking place. By the way, I'm not actually smoking at the moment. Actually quit, last time I had a cigarette was about 24 days ago, but still coughing. But Iran has now tested 9 missiles. And this was done yesterday during their war game simulation and warned the U.S. and Israel that it was ready to retaliate for any attack over its disputed nuclear projects. The missiles are said to be able to hit Israel and the U.S. bases. The day before, on Tuesday, the president of Iran said that he sees no possibility of a war between his country and the U.S. or Israel. The exercises came as the U.S. Navy, in cooperation with the U.K., wrapped up a 6-day exercise in the Persian Gulf, which was called Stake Net. So I want to remind you that Israel just had a drill over the Mediterranean and Greece, simulating an invasion of Iran. Over 100 jets were involved in that particular exercise. Defense Secretary Robert Gates said the U.S. is no closer to confrontation with Iran after Tehran test-fired missiles it says could reach Israel and U.S. assets in the Middle East. After Iran test-fired their missiles, the dollar fell and crude oil rose, rebounding from its biggest decline in 3 months. Now, this next report's kind of big. It comes to us from CNN. U.S. preparing the battlefield in Iran. Journalist Seymour Hersh said recently that the Bush administration has launched a significant escalation of covert operations in Iran, sending U.S. commandos to spy on the country's nuclear facilities and destabilize the country. White House, CIA, and State Department officials declined to comment on the Hersh report, which appeared in this week's edition of The New Yorker. Hersh said that Congress has already authorized $400 million to fund the secret campaign, which involves U.S. special operations troops and Iranian dissidents. He explains how the Bush administration's policy of my enemy's enemy is my friend has led the U.S. to support several organizations, Halanda and the MEK, both of which have clear track records of terrorist activities directed towards the United States. Where they've been funded by the CIA through a black op project is beyond me, not without the realm of possibility, knowing what we know about 9/11. And all the money that we've read about in Iraq just going missing, the pallets of cash money, U.S. dollars, going missing in addition to this. It's like when I think about the Iraq war, I just see a large monumental money laundering operation that most of us can't even see how bad it actually really, really is. Daddy's credit card still works in terms of them having the ability to still borrow money from the banksters, make their money, get the money out of the U.S. into these private contractors that are in Iraq, 150,000 Blackwater. And what kind of a name for a company is that anyway? Blackwater? Death and the worship of it is making me sick at this point. I mean, I just keep running into it over and over and over. The themes, the latest movies coming out, logging on some website and some little graphic comes out at you and says, how many days is it going to be till you die? Click here to find out. The fascination with death, all these different macabre ways that the world is going to end, when we all know that the world is not going to end. We're going through a transition, a big one. And in that transition, we see world war, we see famine, we see starvation, we see death, we see people losing their minds. But we have to get through this era of time that we're in. Look, the geomagnetical field breaking down, weakening. We're now more vulnerable to asteroids, different types of radiation, cosmic radiation, gamma ray bursts, sunspot explosions. The list goes on and on and on. Why now? How can the naysayers, the supposed skeptics, say that we are the same people that were talking about something big happening during Y2K? At that point in my life, when it was 2000, Y2K wasn't on my mind. It was that something big was going to happen in the future, and I did feel when we went from 99 to 2000, that a shift did occur, that we were about to see something big that would change our lives. And a lot of people felt that. A lot of people felt that emptiness between 99 and 2000 and one, kind of being in a limbo state. Where do we go from here with all this technology and living in America? And, you know, the first time I heard the terms martial law and understood what it meant was when I read in the Oregonian, the paper, about and saw in the news the 1999 protest in Seattle, Washington, and how they set up that free speech zone and they sent out these cops in the street looking like troops all padded up, ready to go to war. You know, that woke a lot of people up, that event, and 9/11. So there's going to be bigger things that we're going to have to face in the near future here in Portland, in New York, in LA, in England, because we have viewers there as well, all over. We all have bigger challenges in the future. We have to learn from the challenges we've gone through in the past, that we face in the past, that we're facing now, and get ready for the big ones. That means shedding as many illusions that we have about this world, about reality, as many illusions as we can. There's not a lot of time left, and I want to make sure that I'm very clear about that. Something big is about to take place, and I'm not the only one who feels this way. Now, we're talking now about the escalation of war at the moment. Covert operations in the nation of Iran. And then we'll take some phone calls on this particular issue and where you think it's going. Hirsch warns that we have been moving cruise missiles there for a few months now and that the U.S. military is now ready. Our submarines are there, our destroyers are there. With cruise missiles aboard, our crafts are there, our soldiers are there to attack Iran within 10 to 12 hours of the go-ahead order by President Bush, he says, stressing that troops have to go on the ground in Iran in order to destroy Iran's defensive systems. It's not just going to be an air invasion. They're planning a ground attack. Infantry. Iranian leaders have said they believe that the speculation of a military strike is part of a campaign of psychological warfare. That is possible, too, in terms of the largest picture, the big picture. Who is this guy in Iran? How did he get into power? Who is he really? Why don't we really hear the criticisms of the Iranian government? And why doesn't he really criticize the U.S. government on what we're really guilty of? Not you and me, but the people occupying illegally the White House today. It makes you wonder when they begin to share these sophisticated forms of military technology. DARPA got to where it is today. It's basically, if you were to look at the movie Terminator, it's the Skynet Corporation. It didn't get to where it is today alone. There's been a lot of sharing of technology between the United States and Russia over the years. None of this is by accident. Again, nuclear warheads, the technology to attack with warheads, missile technology, persistent technology, was given to China in the early 1990s through President Bill Clinton. We have other cases where other forms of technology have been shared between China, Russia, and the United States. We even see the United States selling F-16s to Pakistan, the same country that declared martial law not too long ago. A lot of corrupt people in our government, in bed with a lot of corrupt people around the world. And then we see this dictator in Zimbabwe. And we read about the destabilization of Africa, and we're wondering, how bad is it really going to get in Africa to the point where it spreads here? Because we didn't deal with the problem in the first place. We just ignored it. And just let the IMF and the World Bank deal with the problem, and the peacekeepers that they send in get involved in the illegal activities that they're involved in, the raping, the trafficking of women and children. It's going to continue to get worse until something big just shakes up this whole bee's nest, this whole beehive. Before we go to that phone call.
Hello?
Well, we'll go ahead and take it now. Hello, go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much indeed, sir, for taking my call.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Alex Ansary. This is Mo. I would like just to very clarify for your viewers that MK or Mujahideen Khalq-e Iran, they are organizations that are half communist and half Islamic rules and regulation. So that's why we call them Komo Islamic. So just for that reason I called. And there are bases in Iraq, and now they have been released. And U.S. Army are giving them food, I mean, everything. And for the first wave, it would be Mujahideen, MKO, will attack Iran before the American soldier goes the next wave. So if any of them killed, it would be the Mujahideen Khalq Iran. They are the ones who are going to be killed on the first stage of the war with Iran. And their leaders is Maryam Rajavi, and she's in France. And Masoud Rajavi, they were together, but at one time they were separated, and now Maryam Rajavi is in charge of the Mujahideen Khalq Iran, or MKO. So I want just to clarify this for your viewers, and I appreciate your giving me the time to clarify this for your viewers. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Mo, and we will continue to take a look at the issue. Now, the Asian Times reported that a source from the government has said that we are going to be striking Iran within the next 2 months, and that report did come out about a month ago. Now, Iran is only one thing to discuss in terms of, you know, what we're facing on this planet. A lot of people, I'm going to tell you, are going to lose their farms this year. Because of the crop failure in Iowa, they're not going to be able. While we live check to check, they live crop to crop. So there's going to be a lot of consolidation with big agri over the course of the next year. It is going to be phenomenal. What has happened to wheat is going to happen to corn. The price is already shooting up, but no one really asked the question, why so many things at one time in history? Grain silos exploding in Iowa, mysterious fire. It rarely happens at the, you know, at these particular facilities where, you know, usually they can be contained, but to have so much of it destroyed. But, you know, the big picture is all these viruses that are out there attacking wheat, not only UG99, but again, there's a new virus that has been discovered in Kansas that's providing the wheat from fully growing. And then you have the issue with corn and biofuels and the inflation and big agri, GMO in particular, Monsanto and their subsidiaries are positioned to make a lot of money in the next year to provide the third world with seed where they need aid. So again, they're going to get loan more money, and they're going to have to, it's going to be a, okay. So was there another phone call that was waiting? Was that what you were, okay. So it's going to be a big, big wave of consolidation, and it's a little bit overwhelming. So that's the food end, and we see this stuff happening with the banks. The Royal Bank of Scotland has basically issued a major, major warning that in the near future there's going to be a crash where there's not going to be any credit running around any longer. You see, it's funny money. The whole thing's funny money, and we're running out of it. We print too much of it. We run out of the value itself. That is leaving the country, and that's what people don't fully understand. People ask, you know, will people wake up and kind of figure it all out after the crash? And the answer is no, not at all. There'll be people waking up to different realities that they may need to wake up. It may be part of their, excuse my metaphysical French, their karma, their, you know, what is necessary in their life to evolve. We're all on different paths in this lifetime. But in order to, you know, change the White House and, you know, reverse these things and reverse this Big Brother state, no, we're going quicker and quicker in terms of acceleration into the future, into the brave new world. Thumb scanning machines being put up to work, you know, the databases that they're setting up. Every now and then we use somebody's, wireless connection. You know, when we're on the internet at a coffee shop or something, or when we're at our apartment, I was using my neighbor's, and really wasn't a big deal. You know, people have used my internet access before. What came up though is she was working on a software project that was highly sensitive for a certain big time software company in the Northwest. So she was working with this project, and they had told her there was an IP address accessing her wireless service that was being flagged or watched by the government. So I found this out a couple days ago, and you see, we're not moving into a world where they're going to reverse the spying, the targeting, the positioning that they're planning to do in the future. They're not going to reverse that. It's accelerating. Take a very close look at the Obama phenomenon and the Messiah effect, and you'll understand exactly what I'm talking about and where we are today in terms of the collective consciousness and the herd mentality existing in America today. It is frightening. I will spare you the rant that I can go on for hours and hours and hours begging you to look behind the throne. But it won't do any good unless you feel the incentive with a suspicion in your own heart, unless you're aware or you're feeling it yourself. It's not going to mean anything because you have to find that truth and question for yourself on your own. Instead of thinking that another leader is going to lead us out of this hellhole, this basket that we're in today. This person, Obama, that's saying that it's okay to continue to spy and the corporations won't be held accountable. And then we have a report over here just out that he's looking to abolish the constitutional amendment that got rid of slavery. That's forced servitude in America. They may not actually abolish that part of the Constitution, but the way that Obama is moving and the way he's talking, it sounds like he is. The U.S. already has high rates of volunteerism. That's apparently not good enough for our presidential candidates. I'm now reading from the LA Times, one of the opinion columns that I want to pull out because he made a lot of good points as to how insane it's all getting in this AmeriCult. An AmeriCult spelled with three K's instead of one C. There's a weird irony at work when Senator Barack Obama, the black presidential candidate who will allegedly scrub the stain of racism from the nation, vows to run afoul the constitutional amendment that abolished slavery. For those that don't remember, the 13th Amendment says, and I quote, "Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude except as punishment for crime shall exist within the United States." I guess in Obama's mind, it must be a crime to go to college because in a speech on national service Wednesday at the University of Colorado, Obama promised that as president, he would set a goal for all American middle and high school students to perform 50 hours of service a year, and for all college students to perform 100 hours of service a year. He would see that these goals are met by, among other things, attached strings to federal education dollars. And a lot of people know that there's a big spiral of debt that a lot of people in my generation are in right now over student loans. And I do also want to, in terms of predictions for next year, get ready for high interest rates for any of us that are still in debt, big time. When these banks consolidate, especially when they're foreign corporations and foreign banks, they're no longer domestic. You either talk to them on the phone or you talk to them over the web, more likely over the web than phone in the future, or an automatic robot with AI technology. Obama would see that these goals are met by other things, attached strings to federal educational dollars. If you don't make the kids report for duty, he's essentially telling schools and college kids, you'll lose money you can't afford to lose. In short, he'll make service compulsory by merely compelling schools to make it compulsory. You know, it's funny that when the right seeks to use the government to impose its values, this guy notes out, the left screams about brainwashing and propaganda. The left tries it, the right thunders about social engineering, but when left and right agree, as seems to be the case on national service, who's left to complain? And that's an excellent point. As ever, the slippery slopes are greased with the snake oil of bipartisanship. After all, Obama's hardly alone. McCain is also for involuntary servitude to the state, as well as, you guessed it, Judge W. John Edwards is also a fan of compulsory national service. No, it isn't slavery, but it contributes to a slave mentality, the author of this opinion editorial says, at odds with the American tradition. It assumes that work not done for the government isn't really for the common good. Indoctrinating an entire generation with the idea that public service is something you do at the government's behest will not only steamroll the culture, it would help fewer people in the process. In the next report, Obama, Blackwater, troubling, but here to stay. Back in February, Barack Obama caught flack from some liberals for refusing to rule out deploying private security companies like Blackwater worldwide in Iraq. In a wide-ranging interview with the Military Times, Obama repeated and explained his views on guns for hire. They are going to be used for private contractors, he said, and not just in the mess hall or behind a forklift. He says that he has his own bill that is critical of Blackwater and that it would hold private contractors accountable. So we have a big polarity difference between actions and rhetoric that most people can't see. There is something very magical, mystifying, and hypnotic about the Obama campaign. The symbols of the rising sun that have been used for years that are in his campaign signs, some of the pictures that have been taken with light coming out of his body. We'll take a look at some of the pictures in a couple of weeks with our guest, Jerome Corsi, who has recently authored a book about Obama. We will also try to get Webster Tarpley to come on to talk about his book, Exposing Barack Hussein Muhammad Obama. To return to the other pieces of news, U.S. signs missile defense shield with the Czech Republic. This is after Moscow warned it would use military means if the shield were deployed close to its borders. The U.S. signed the pact on Tuesday. The Russian Foreign Ministry said if the real deployment of an American strategic missile defense shield begins close to our borders, then we will be forced to react not with diplomatic methods, but with military technical methods. About 1,500 citizens have protested against the Czech-U.S. agreement on the deployment of a missile defense radar station on the Czech Republic in downtown Prague. According to the latest polls, 3/4 of the Czech population is opposed to the construction of the radar station. Well, hell yeah, because that's going to put them in the middle of a war zone. Russia, strategic bombers continue Arctic and Atlantic patrols. They have resumed them over the Pacific as well, following an order signed by former President Vladimir Putin. Russian bombers have since carried out over 80 strategic patrol flights and have often been escorted by NATO planes. Now, it's been announced that Russia is starting a large-scale naval exercise in the Pacific. As we speak, live fire is taking place in the Pacific, likely directed towards us, and they're off the coast of Japan. It includes the core of the Naval Task Force. Again, this started 2 days ago. Participating in the exercise consists of a Russian Slava-class missile cruiser, dubbed the killer of aircraft carriers, and some other attack destroyer ships and missile boats. According to the exercise scenario, the Russian Naval Task Force and shore-based naval aircraft are tasked with the search and destruction of an aggressor force. Pardon me? One phone call?
Yeah.
Okay. Attempting to establish a beachhead on the Russian coast. They're preparing to fight an aggressor trying to establish Russian territory. The ships will conduct a series of live fire drills against ground, surface, and air targets. During the exercise, the ships will test fire new surface to air missiles at a target drone. I believe this will be the last quiet summer. Go ahead, caller.
Hi, Alex.
Hi.
This is Barrett. It's really scary how many people choose to put their head in the sand rather than look at what's in front of their face. I got a letter from the DMV, which I don't know, I could figure out some call letters for that one, because it's turning fascist, and this is why. This letter I got stated, this is a vehicle I don't use very often. I got a truck, motorcycle, and a car, and I don't always have them all insured. It's on private property. Okay, this lady, I got a demand letter. It said basically, you either get insurance. We want to see if you get, we want proof of insurance that you have insurance on this motorcycle. And if you don't, you're gonna be on an SR-22 for the minimum requirements for like bodily injury.
Barrett,
insurance. Yes.
Were you pulled over, or you just got a letter?
I got a letter.
Okay.
Well,
is good info, because they're already premeditatively looking like, look, we have to modernize the system. Eventually, you'll get to the point where they'll set up cameras just to go through everyone's license plate number, see if they're insured.
That's bullshit.
And then send
too.
Out the cop to that specific spot after they've been dispatched by the automated panopticon in the sky.
Here's what scared me was the gal I was talking to on the phone didn't see anything wrong with it.
No.
Anyway, that's my comment.
Well, thank you. And, you know, I thank you for your call, Barrett. And I whined about the parking tickets and the money I had to pay after, you know, I didn't pay some of them. They duplicated. They went to the state. They garnished some of my wages last year. It was really irritating. It wasn't so much the money, it was the idea that I did feel powerless and that my hands were tied. And so then you learn to adjust your behavior, like no longer parking downtown, where you learn what the game is. Unfortunately, we're being pushed out of our cars. Now, the tensions are high right now between bikers and motorists. And it's not good. I don't believe, and I want to actually haven't said this yet. Certain animals like lions and puppy dogs, you know, shouldn't coexist together. The thing is, it's dangerous on the road, and I think we do need to figure out how bicyclists and cars can coexist, but not in the same space. You see what I'm saying? I'm more in favor of extended bike lanes, but to be in the same space, you know, it slows up traffic. And it's dangerous for the biker. And as someone that isn't biking right now, but I am actually looking for a bike, by the way, if someone has an extra one. But to keep this simple, the times I've biked, I like the sidewalk. I don't actually like the fact that I have to be on the street. That makes me really uncomfortable. I don't want to be in a situation where I feel like I have to be driving or riding my bike alongside cars to ride my bike. I think that's wrong. I'm actually, you know, I'm one of those people that see something wrong with that. So the situation is that we're gonna have to find a solution to this problem that we have, and everyone's got an opinion on it, and people are very aggressive when they enter the roads. You know, roid rage, there's also bike rage, hence the front page of today's Oregonian, where, you know, you have a scuffle, an argument between a motorist and a bicycle who loses their temper and attacks the motorist with their bike. Very close to where I live, there's a lot of violence and activity in a very, very close radius of where I hang my coat every night. And so you got to keep yourself strong as you move into the future. And the second thing I want to say is Barrett brought up a point about, you know, was something I talk about a lot about, you know, how ingrained people are in the matrix, in the system, how frightening it is. And it's also dangerous to us to see so many people keep their head in the sand and put us further into danger. We have to understand that we are animals physically, biologically, but we're also social animals, and we have amazing imaginations and intellect that can create amazing destruction and great beauty at the same time. We have to learn that the hive mind of our species is poisoned to a certain degree, and mind control is a reality in today's world, whether it be advertising or it be a black heart program or it be you know, blatant propaganda coming out of the TV set. Or, you know, listening to Army War ads as you sleep at night on a commercial clear channel station, or those flashy things that you're seeing that show an image at you so fast that you don't even know that it's there. When you get even on the web in some of those animated flashes that ask you how many days is it going to be until you die, when we become aware there's something wrong, we can learn that sometimes we have to step back from the herd, from the collective, and find our own center. And that has to be done now. That has to be done now, because things are getting more dangerous, things are getting more volatile, things are getting crazier. So will be people and suicide rates, but it's also the opportunity for massive growth. Now with the news, this is something a lot of people aren't aware of when you ask the question, who's really pulling the strings? Is it really a war, or is someone orchestrating this war from above for us as a species to kill each other out to make way for something else? A new world or a new way of living under a new rule by God knows what. You know they're waiting for something in 2012 as well. They want to have everything HD in both radio and TV by that date. When you get into just to how much they understand about the mind, how to tweak it, how to beam a voice into someone's head, an image into someone's head, to heat up their body, to make them scream, to make them vomit with a flashlight, all these different technologies being given out to local police departments, people being attacked, their IPs being watched, their phones being tapped. Where are we really going to go with this? 1984 was written a long time ago, my friends. It is passé compared to the technology today that only Adolf Hitler, Mussolini, Mao Zedong, and all the other bastard dictators that came before Bush could only salivate and dream and masturbate over. These people are sick, and as long as we continue to judge them by our own moral compass, the way we would judge ourselves, we're going to lose. It's about evolution. And, you know, consciousness has to come to the point where it's greater than the level of consciousness that created the problem to begin with. Report, Iran acquiring fighter jets that are based on Israeli technology. Oh, yeah, Jerusalem Post. Iran has signed a deal with China to purchase 24 J-10 fighter jets between 2008 and 2010. According to the Russian news agency, the jets were developed based on the technology of Israel's Lviv fighter jet, whose technology was sold to China against the wishes of the U.S. Now, this particular jet was developed in the 80s. We're talking about the J-10 here. The project was canceled following pressure from America, which feared, check this out, that the new jet would compete with the F-16 in the international marketplace. Ah, the U.S. subsequently sold F-16s to Israel to reduce cost, as well as Pakistan. China began developing the J-10 in 2004. They currently have, according to this report, 89 aircraft in active service. The veil's thinning. More and more people are starting to see what's going to take place in a short span of time in the near future. You know, we have a report here, Invisible Wars of the Future, E-bombs, laser guns, and acoustic weapons. There are four weapons that have come out, reports that I've seen come out from different news agencies talking about the future weapons of the world, future weapons that will be used in World War III, in the next big conflict, from laser weapons to, again, we're talking about things that can cause an entire nation to lose its mind. For the ears to ring so loud that they explode. For people to feel like they're melting inside. For people to think like they're seeing God come down from the sky and it's actually time for the rapture. Like someone's literally playing the Bible scene by scene. Including Revelations 9:11, where the destroying angel comes out of the burning pit. U.S. finds it's getting crowded in space. China plans to conduct its first spacewalk in October. The European Space Agency is building a roving robot to land on Mars. India recently launched a record 10 satellites into space on a single rocket. Space, like Earth below, is globalizing. And as it does, America has long held superiority in exploring, exploding, and commercializing. The final frontier is slipping away, many experts believe. When we all know that all it's about is pushing one single button. When we look at the future of war, we have to stop the madness now. Now, there's some things that we can't stop, and some wheels are already in motion. We have to prepare and adjust our perspective of reality and understand why we're going through this. Why are we born into an environment where this is taking place, where we feel so defenseless, when we're not? But why are we going through this challenge in our life? Why are we here? One of the most amazing and destructive, intelligent, beautiful, all these different things taking place in this time-space reality. What the hell is going on? I mean, we're going to see a lot of stuff in our lifetimes. We know that. Brain chips, microchips, E.T., fake invasions, World War III. I mean, the list goes on. Wars over water. International World Army troops after the fall of the U.S. What's going to happen to our economy? I mean, allowed to go on. Piece by piece, America will continue to be devoured and eaten by people that don't even live in this country, that are making decisions far, far away from here. Vatican says that aliens are our brothers. We're seeing more and more movies where the ETs are coming out to assist us in saving our planet. WALL-E is in theaters now. I was walking through the mall the other day. There were always crazy things that I see in the mall. I just walk in there just to kind of shock my system. I actually skimmed an entire book in 1 hour called 2013. It was all over these different perspectives on 2012 at Borders at Lloyd Center. But, you know, you just want to freak yourself out and go into a mini horse show just for 5 seconds. So I walked into the video game avenue and, wow, we got about 10 games where the kids are ready to ride around in exoskeletons fighting the future wars remotely. Maybe not even on the battlefield. Everybody lined up. Then you go outside, and there's Comcast with their little booth set up. And there's a little kid, though, in this ad for Alien World, where he's looking at his watch, and he's communicating with these draconian reptilian characters. And I'm just like, and then I'm looking at this like commercial for this kids cartoon about 6 months ago. It's this cartoon that's on Cartoon Central. Well, these kids are contaminated by something in the water supply that causes them to genetically mutate into reptilian dinosaurs that are superheroes to save the world. What am I getting at? Am I ranting like a lunatic? Or am I so sane it just appears that way? There's something wrong with where the direction of the children's minds are going, with where DNA is going, where with the world of nanotechnology and genetic mutation, crossbreeding different species. I mean, we live in a world where people think it's normal that people eat food that came from a seed that has a sterility trait that tells it after a year you kill yourself. Yet we put food in our body that's been programmed by evil mofos to kill itself. We're programmed. You are what you eat. Uh-huh. Suicides are going up, you say? What the hell's going on? When we accept that this is going to be normal, that eating is not a human right, that drinking water is not a human right, that shelter is not a human right, that the right to not have your mind be bombarded with radio waves and advertising. Where are we going to find a world where not having those things in our mind is a human right? We're not in that world now. They already do test runs. You walk into malls sometimes. I don't know of any in Portland, but they've done some in the UK. The UK is a bizarre, bizarre place. We don't have time to get into their surveillance grid. You walk up, and they set up one in New York as well. The thing just tells you, hey, you, over here. Ding, 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 bell, bell, bell. Hello. Hi. Hi, how are you doing? New series, new show coming to you from Disney, The Unexplained Phenomenon. This was a real report. We went over it about a year ago. They're testing something in the street. People are going, who was that? They look around, behind you. How is that not a crime? If that is taking place, how long have they had this technology? And what else are in, what is in the signals that are out there? The mystery behind cell phone masks. You know, one time we ran out of time on the show a couple weeks ago, and the last report was cell phone masks in the UK linked to suicide. Again, all these people that are just killing themselves, that they find to be located in this cell phone mask zone. And I live in an area of tons of cell phone masks, and so do a lot of people in Portland. And you walk around and people go, you know, it just seems that people are just walking like they're in a trance. And for those that go, I don't have a cell phone, it doesn't matter. You're not really reducing it. It's what's out here that's larger than just that cell phone. It's the whole electromagnetic spectrum. It makes me wonder, man, if sunspots come and they start attacking that and something's happening with the field and it messes with that, is that a bad thing? Or is it going to make it worse? I can tell you that we are now looking at the London Telegraph reporting on the side, in addition to all this stuff in the movies about aliens and the video games and all this other stuff, and the Vatican saying that aliens are our brothers. Here we have the London Telegraph saying that British UFO sightings reach bizarre levels. With their alien activity or natural phenomena, reports of UFOs have flooded in the summer from across the country. Whatever the explanation, experts agree that the number of suspected flying saucers has hit unusual highs this summer. Malcolm Robinson, who studies the phenomenon, says something very bizarre is happening in the skies of the UK. Some experts believe craft from outer space are appearing because they are concerned about what man is doing to this planet. Move along. Move along. Nothing to see here. I want to say something about... refrain from name-calling. The economy is falling. Less of us have money. It's tough to see a lot of people in the street that need money. Things are going to get worse. More people are sleeping in their cars. Even in California, they've designated certain places for people to sleep in their vehicles in some cities slowly. This is all being done out of compassion. people with property that will allow them on their property to do this. Men over here, women over there, keep it a little bit safe. Things are dangerous for women on the street. A lot of people really don't know the stories. I happen to know more than the average person about what people go through on the street. And the reality is, a lot of us could be facing that reality or the refugee experience in the coming years, with a lot of people losing their homes by design because our ability to take care of ourselves is being removed from our hands. It's a, oh man, things are so damn good right now. I have no, we have no clue. We have no clue how good things are right now. It is in free fall. And that's why all this stuff's been developed. Look, back to the story. I'm walking on Hawthorne. A lot of people are out there that are looking to get money. Environmental Oregon, Children International, and Greenpeace. And the opening, you know, conversation started for them is, hey, do you want to help out the kids? It's an insinuation that if you don't give money to them, you're not helping out the kids. And a lot of them can be a little bit rude if you can't. See, the issue that I'm having and I want to point out is that we have a lot of people that are responding to these billboards that are popping up all around the country in Portland. Get paid to be a progressive, to be sustainable. Get paid to change the planet. You know, so they go, they type in this number, and it's all about you working for commission to get money for this organization, a lot of them which have shady track records. Some of them are good, and some of them have donated good causes, but a lot of them are doing that solely because they're making money while, you know, I'm not wanting here, I'm making a point. I'm doing this because I'm really seeing big danger come our way, and I don't see, you know, a little bit of money in organization changing things. I'm seeing some big things shift, and a big problem is lack of information as to what's going on. So I feel it's vital that I come here and tell you that, hey, the government's involved in false flag terror. They're involved in using food as a weapon. They're interested in bringing down the population through immoral means. There are powers that be operating today on our planet that we cannot possibly comprehend. We need to take a look and question our reality. Now, I'm not asking for, you know, a thank you. What I'm saying here is it's frustrating. So I experienced an encounter where someone called me a liar because I said I didn't have enough to contribute, but I wished them good luck. And this was after I'd already was asked by seven other people, because now there's three on a block instead of one or two. There'll be one at the end, one in the middle, and one at the other end. So you have to go through, you know, five people to get to there, to get to your destination if you're walking from, say, 32nd Hawthorne, and you're going to walk the strip up to, say, 42nd, get some lunch at the Thai place, whatever, get some... Oh, by the way, there'll be a new Seasons where Daily Grind used to be. That's going to be coming later. But you're walking around, and they figure that's the place to go because people are spiritual, hanging out, Hawthorne, hippie, yay, free spirit, yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, hey, they'll give us some money. So to turn around and call somebody a liar is, you know, not cool. Now, the reason I went into that is because when I responded and defended myself, it became herd mentality, mob mentality, where his peers came to back him up and began to yell at me and tell me to go away and, you know, I just don't care about the kids. And so we're going to see a lot of divisions and a lot of emotions and anger come up with so-called progressives and people of the right. Forget labels. People in general in the city, they're going to be reacting. Just try to go a day without eating. And I may eat breakfast, but I'll tell you, if I don't eat, sometimes I just don't even eat breakfast sometimes, and I just forget. I'm better with that now. But I will be very agitated and angry or whatever, grumpy by 3 o'clock, you know, and then maybe I'll eat. And so a lot of people do that because we live busy lives. Imagine people after a couple days. You know, there's going to be a lot of finger-pointing, a lot of name-calling, a lot of people pulling up the knife a little too quickly, ironically, while they're wearing a tie-dye t-shirt with hemp clothing. Totally, like, forgetting, like, what this was all about, the coming together, forgetting that we are one people and we have to come together as a collective to not let our emotions override us over who we think is right and who we think is wrong. We have a lot of people that are convinced that people that don't like Obama are racist. They've gotten almost in this fascist mentality that, you know, this guy can do no wrong. It's almost pleasurable just to say the word Obama. I mean, it's just the things that are so obvious out there that aren't being seen by the locals is, again, frightening and a little bit dangerous to those of us that are really trying to restore freedom So we need to hang on. Again, dangerous times are coming. I'm letting you know now. Sometimes I wonder, I think at night, what does Lars think about all this? Is he beginning to wake up? Does he have a question in his own heart? You know, the nature of reality, what God really is, or the universe, this collective consciousness, this path to destruction? How about Rush Limbaugh? How about Sean Hannity? Like, no, not how do they sleep at night? What do they really, really think about at night when no one's around and the lights are out and they're alone by themselves? Or are they just simply popping pills just to make it through the next day like the rest of the collective sheep that I walked amongst, whether it's pills or alcohol or cigarettes or television or the iPod that a lot of people are just hooked right into you because that and the cell phone, you know, it's just much more interesting than the person walking towards you in the street. And I walk down the street now and I just see bars wherever I walk. You know, you see the billboard says, hey, Verizon, the bars are everywhere. And I'm going, I'll say, you know, you see it and it does bring tears to the eyes because I will not stop feeling. In fact, I'm beginning to feel more than I've ever felt in my life. They've worked to keep us in a left brain state of consciousness. When you explode the possibility of the right brain and you truly seek to feel free, to understand where we came from, where we're going, what's really controlling the planet, you can't go back. As many people have said before, one person cannot unhear something once they've heard it. So when you're out there talking to people, friends, family, otherwise, you're planting seeds. Nurture them. Give the seeds love, give them water, give them the nutrients that they need, and step back and let nature do the rest. And we will go to the next phone call. And we have one more report. We're going to be talking about some of the big sickness taking place in China right now, and we're not just talking about the Olympics. Go ahead.
Alex, hi. This is Court. I just wanted to say thank you. It's good to see you back on the box. I wanted to ask you if you've covered RFID chips before on the Oregon driver's license. The RFID chip is being issued now on the new cards. I've just received one. I didn't, of course, agree to that, but it's been issued on my card nonetheless.
Yeah, we told people, we started talking about that 3 years ago.
3 years
ago.
We
were talking about the national ID card system, which they're implementing, the Real ID Act of 2005. They keep pushing it back because they're trying to get all the states lined up. The recent news on that is that Homeland Security brought down the price so more states could afford it. So a lot of states are on their way to being compliant with that. And Oregon, although some people think Portland's progressive, Oregon is right on board with complying with anything that the federal government wants. And that includes Ted Kulongoski, our governor, and Mayor Potter.
Exactly. And then combining that, of course, with cell towers and satellite technology, it seems to be an interesting tagging system for chattel. For the corporate oligopolies or corporate oligopolistic monopoly to, you know, keep track of what we're buying, when we're buying it, et cetera, et cetera. But I wanted to thank you again, thank you as well for mentioning in your news briefing there of what's going on overseas. It might be a good time to invest in futures again on oil. Excuse me, I know that's not funny, but you know, what can I say?
If you think you're going to be able to get the money when everything's, when the smoke clears, and I'm beginning to question that.
Yes.
I think a lot of people with money are getting ready to lose a lot of money, and they're going to be alongside you and me, and you and me are going to be talking to them about, we told you so, but not to put in your face, now what do we do now, my friend? Because, again, there's no one now saying, hey, Alex, you were right. I understood what you're saying about the RFID, because, hell, you know, surveillance and whatnot, I got a thumb scan to work at this hotel in downtown Portland now. I mean, I'm actually hearing stories about one particular hotel. You got a thumb scan to work. RFID, yes. You know, you want to look at the little Wi-Fi system that they put up downtown. Well, now they're saying they're not going to fund that anymore. You know, the free Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
But that technology will still stay downtown because it can be used by Homeland Security and it can detect RFID. Homeland Security put it in the first place. So
right.
They're not about to take down the infrastructure that they're setting up in our own city.
No.
Well, I want to thank you for your call.
Yes, it's been a pleasure. Thank you.
In a last report, 300 protesters arrested after riot. But again, tens of thousands of protesters were going crazy in China, the biggest protest in China since Tiananmen Square. It was quashed recently. Currently, a large number of paramilitary and riot police are stationed in the country. TV stations and radio have been urging people to turn themselves into police. Here is the official reason that the Chinese government wants you to think that they're protesting. The investigation of a death. What really happened, according to thousands of people, including it was started in a village, a girl was raped and murdered by the son of a local politician. The uncle went to investigate, and he didn't like the investigation done by the police, so they beat him to death. A protest started in the village. They begin to cover it up and censor blogs coming out of China as to what happened. And then later it was revealed that the girl that was raped and murdered had her organs removed, including her uterus. And then it has also come out that in China, this is happening to other women as well. We are entering an era of great darkness where people are willing to do horrific things to one another. I do believe our consciousness at this time can shift, but it is not going to happen to all of us. What I'm saying is critical now as we leave tonight. Some of us can reach enlightenment in our lifetimes. However, we are going to have to learn to do it sometimes physically alone without people in our world. You know, I've struggled with that one, even if it's just on the web or a phone call here and there, because we will see people becoming beasts. I don't know about literally. I don't put it off the table. I mean, but at least metaphorically and in terms of energetically, people are reacting in some insane ways. So the future is a uncertain thing, but I will tell you that the stability that we're facing now, that we're dealing with now, that we're experiencing with the economy, you know, the fact that you can go to an ATM and get your credits out or these dollar bills and it actually being able to buy you something in the store, it's leaving. We have to be aware. We have to grow physically. We have to grow spiritually. We have to grow psychologically, because now in this era of darkness and deception, you can't trust the papers, you can't trust the TV, you can't trust the radio. For your own sanity and reality, you want to get further and further away from technology, not more ingrained in it. The reality is, today, more than ever, the path to the ultimate truth still starts within, and will become that way, increasingly so, in the future. Day after day, year after year. Good night.